Welcome back to the Mob Mentality Show. My name is Austin Chadwick. My co-host is Chris Lucian. And very, very excited to have Kyle Griffin on the show today. This is a pleasure for me because Kyle and I have had several great conversations over the last several months, just kind of agile and mob slash pairing practitioners and sharing and learning a lot. And then also recently, Kyle got to participate in a mob workshop with us where he did a fantastic job facilitating a mob. So yeah, really excited about this conversation. We're going to be hitting a few things. We'll see where it lands us, though. Agile facets, time frames of Agile, principles under the manifesto, and if there's time, maybe militant humility and things like that. So we'll see where we go, though. Before we get started on the topics, Kyle, can you give us an introduction to yourself?
That's always the hard one, right? I'm Kyle. I was teaching programming back in the 90s, and then I'm going, how do I get these people to understand good design? Because that's a heck of a thing. You can teach people how to write code and if statements and all that, and how do you get good code? And I'm, hey, how about we do the OO stuff? Okay, great. Didn't work. How about we do patterns? Well, it works if you've got 10 years of experience and you can reference the patterns you know, but it still didn't work. And what happens if we do a co-blended OO theory with a language in the middle? And yeah, maybe a little bit. What can we do to get people to learn decent design? And then I'm in a bookstore, because that's what you did in 2000 if you're geeky enough, right? And I find this book on the computer shelf set called Extreme Programming Explained. And so I pick it up, I read it, and I said, wait, that solves the problem, right? Paired TDD actually fixes the design problem and how to get new developers to learn to design well. I've been looking for this solution for like 10 years. Why didn't I know about this? Oh, it's new. Okay.
Just released, right?
And then they like rebranded into Agile in 2001. Mm. And then all the process people took over Agile in 2004.
And here we are back at XP.
And here we are 20 years later, and I'm still preaching, wait, but you can actually do good design if you do XP.
Nice. Right on. Well, thanks for that intro. Yeah, maybe we'll jump into, how about time frames of Agile first? What are your thoughts there?
So there's this weird thing that I see going on where everybody doing Agile keeps talking about these sprints. And we're trying to optimize, hey, what can we deliver best by the end of the sprint? And going back to what I just said, you know, when I read the XP thing 20 years ago and started teaching it, it was like, you know what I'm optimizing for? I'm optimizing for a time frame like 5 years out. Right? What I'm trying to do is optimize total cost of ownership of this piece of software, total value proposition of the piece of software over the next decade. And if all I'm doing is thinking about the sprint, I'm just a mess. This isn't what the whole thing was built to do. Mm. Right? And so I like to do examples. Everybody knows who Usain Bolt is. Right? Fastest sprinter on the planet. Great. You also know maybe Roger Bannister, the first guy who ran a 4-minute mile.
Cool.
Maybe you know Kipchoge. Kipchoge is the dude who last year, right before COVID, he ran an unofficial under 2-hour marathon.
Wow.
Right? That's as big of a step as Bannister's 4-minute mile. Right? I'm not a runner, right? I run from bears, that's it. Right? And then there's also Giannis Kouros, who's like my favorite runner ever. He's got the world record for 1,000 miles.
Wow.
He can run 1,000 miles. He can run from my house to your house. I'm in Colorado, you're in San Diego. 6.5 days.
That's awesome.
I have trouble driving it in that fast, but yeah. So when I talk about software, it's like, what kind of race are we running?
Yeah.
Are we running a Usain Bolt sprint? Well, then you eat one way and you train one way and you pick the people with that kind of physiology. And or are we running the Yannis Kouros race? Because I would do very different things in one case than I did in the other.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right? And if you want to do a sprint, great. Tell me you're doing a sprint and tell me I'm going to optimize for today and I know it's going to be worse tomorrow.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. That's a legitimate call. I've seen prototyping cases where that's the smart thing to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
And so you're referencing kind of this tendency in the industry to basically pick a target, basically make multiple sprints for a waterfall timeline, so to speak. Right. Yeah. And so that, I mean, that's really a prevalent thing, and some people might suffer this often. Or, you know, sometimes referred to as scrummer fall and other things like that, right? And so do you have, how does this analogy help you when talking to people that you're working with, and, you know, what impact has it had for them going forward?
It mostly helps in communication with management in product owner type roles. If you're talking to the product owner and they say, hey, look, this is the next thing I need it right now,
mm-hmm.
right? I always come back and say, okay, you got two choices. I can do it like in 2 days, and then all your future stories cost 10% more. Mm-hmm. Not some of them, all of them, because we screwed up the code base and right? So yeah. There's three choices. You do it in 2 days and then all future stories cost 10% more, right? And that's the normal thing I see in trying to do Scrum is do it in 2 days. Now all future stories cost 10% more. But when you've got 20 stories and 1.1 to the 20th is a big number,
yeah.
Right?
Compounding interest and taking out so many loans that you're underwater day one.
Yeah. And so just giving options. Or do you want to take 3 days and it'll be a little bit more expensive for the future? Or do you want to take 4 days and then all future stuff maybe gets a little bit cheaper, right?
Yeah.
You make the call, but there's no pretending that we can do it as fast as possible and have no future consequences.
Yeah, it's like the triangle, quality, speed, and what was the third? Yeah.
I always do it quality, rate, and time.
Cost, rate, yeah. Quality, rate, and time, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and what I love about it is I like how you started with the analogy of runners, because analogies always help things resonate, right? You know, like there's the financial technical debt analogy and then the runner analogy. And I think, I know, Chris, you love learning more sports analogies to use in your conversations. So.
When you said, yeah, you know all these people, I'm like, nope. Go right over my head. That's okay. I learned a lot today.
But I mean, I think it helps communicate. I think it helps like the product owner or the team think big picture, like, hey, are we making a product that we're going to, you know, we want to deliver value continuously, but are we playing the long-term game, or are we trying to like make a game that's going to win the market and they're going to throw it away in a couple months or something like that, right? And I think it helps communicate what a lot of developers experience. So if I rewind 5 years, I've done the sprint cycle of doom where we, you know, where the first 30 sprints were fantastic. You know, well, the first five were great. The first next 30 were okay. And then like the next 50 after that were like, you know, hundreds of bugs and everything's hard. And why, you know, there's all these, you know, questions coming into the team. It's like, we went from the heroes to the goats, you know, of the organization in that time, you know what I mean? And so,
And just knowing that those two choices are connected, right? Yeah. That's the problem and I don't think enough of us tech leaning agilists say that loudly and early enough.
Yeah.
Right. And the other part of the problem I have is we're not talking the language of the people who are doing the work, mm-hmm. who are ordering the work. So saying, you can be faster today and slower tomorrow, or slower today and faster tomorrow, and those are your only choices, is a really strong thing to say. And a lot of product people just have never heard it, or the technical folks who say it back down. No, I want it faster today and faster tomorrow. Well, I want a pink unicorn, but I ain't getting one.
Yeah, you know, it was, I recently was in a discussion with a product owner, and I found, you know, the whole compounding interest analogy helped a lot, right? And just saying, hey, we're going to take out a loan here and get it done fast, and then we're going to go and pay that loan off before getting another loan, lest we need to file for bankruptcy. And that's kind of been a go-to for a while. But I like this. It provides a different spin on it and maybe a different angle. And somewhat related, but unrelated, I recently was reading Leadership is Language. And one of the analogies given for vertical slices was a 7-layer dip. And so it's like, you scoop off all the cheese and eat it at the same time. And then you scoop off all the sour cream and then eat that at the same time. And then you scoop off all, or you go and get all 7 layers in one scoop and eat that. And so it was just like some of these analogies, like that was just like so entertaining when I saw that. I like stuff like this because it provides kind of a medium of communication across disciplines. And I think it's really—
love it. Yeah. Have you heard Tech Dishes?
Mm-hmm.
So I have taken to saying tech debt leaves people believing that you can take out loans and you can keep borrowing money,
yeah,
right? I tend to talk about it these days in tech dishes instead.
Okay.
Great, don't do your dishes for a day.
Oh,
that just means you get to do them tomorrow.
Yeah, and then you run out.
Don't do your dishes for a month.
Yeah. Go buy paper plates for the next, you know.
Go buy, yeah. Don't do dishes for 6 months. Burn the house.
Yeah.
Right? It's a toxic place to be now.
Yeah. I like that. Yeah. I like that.
Yeah, and I think these metaphors are great. I mean, the previous person we had on the show, Alex Bird, he posted the other day, a metaphor doesn't prove anything, but man, it helps people understand, right? And I think, this is going back a long time, you know, Aristotle was saying the greatest thing by far is to have the command of a metaphor, right? And so I think, and going back to extreme programming, that was part of it, right?
Yeah, look, I Beck said system metaphor, nobody understood what he meant, right? Mm-hmm. Just like nobody understood when OO said abstraction, right? Right? They're the same idea. But basically, yeah, it's the part of object-oriented analysis. It's the domain-driven design parts of, no, you actually have to have a mental model and understand. Have you all looked at the clean language stuff?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Hmm. No? Okay.
Yeah.
So clean language is an area of discussion started in psychology, but effectively it's a discussion of human use of metaphor and how to say, so I've got my metaphor for how things are going on. You've got your metaphor, Chris, Austin, because I see you at first on my screen. Chris has his metaphor, right? I was just pointing at the screen, right?
Yeah.
And so we all have a metaphor. So here's the question. How do I build a shared metaphor, or how do I uncover your metaphor so that when I say something, I'm not going messy and trying to go in a direction that doesn't make any sense to you, right? Yeah. How do we actually do that? And there's a new-ish discipline called clean language. Mm-hmm. Judy Reese, Caitlin Walker are the big names, Sharon Small, and they are studying the use of how we try and expose our metaphors, how we try to uncover other people's metaphors for effective communication. It's a huge deal.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. I find that looking for contextual similarities, you know, so it's interesting because before I worked in, you know, environmental chemistry contracting and military contracting. And before that I worked in, you know, like medical billing and collection software and stuff. And so when I started working at a manufacturing company and then seeing the direct comparisons to lean and finding a shared metaphor became a lot easier than in other organizations that I was in. And so it was surprising that, you know, in an organization that was practicing lean elsewhere and then taking that and talking about lean in the rest of the organization from a software standpoint, once those shared analogies started to exist, it built a lot of momentum. And so I think it was a unique experience to see that happen. And but in other places, so finding the metaphor that fits and coalesces with the company's context and bringing it is really important. So it's like, no matter your organization, just finding, you know, what equivalents to Agile and Lean does your company or your organization practice. I think I found that to be really helpful.
Likewise. So my buddy Tom, he got to all of this through the OO modeling and Rebecca Werf Sprock's work from the 80s. And he used to she was mentoring him a little bit. Mm-hmm. And so he got to this whole metaphor as a central thing that way. I come from education. I learned all of this with Montessori.
Nice.
Right?
Nice. Yeah, okay.
And that makes sense. Montessori constructivist educational models where you have to build a territory for somebody to construct a map from. And then you get to explore what their map is and how they're thinking about it. Some other folks got there from psychology. My favorite book on the topic is From Contempt to Curiosity by Caitlin Walker. I think it's just a magnificent book.
Yeah. And kind of on that, maybe I'll sneak in one topic that I was hoping to talk to you about on that one. You coined a phrase that I really find that kind of goes with that book title, just kind of militant humility. Do you mind jumping on that a little bit before we jump to the next topic? Yeah,
sure. I actually usually say I am a humilitant, right? Just mash the words together because it conveys the same notion. And it stops people for a moment. So if I summarize Agile in one sentence, I say, Agile's the theory that I'm gonna be wrong a lot. Right?
Yeah, for sure.
I don't believe, I mean, I've got some ideas. I've got a bucket full of experience. I've got a lot of smart ideas. But then I got to thinking, so I was a math champion in California in like the 90s, right? I led Cal Poly San Luis Obispo to some of their best math contest showings ever in the history of the school. I won state level math competition. I was pretty good,
yeah.
Right? You know, on my SAT, I got 790 like 20 times. It wasn't 20, it was about 7. Right?
Sure.
I missed a question every time I took the test. Mm. And that's me as one of the best people in the state at the age. We make mistakes. We all make mistakes. When I'm the best at something, I still make mistakes. Mm. The best batters in the world hit one time in three.
Right.
In sports, because Chris likes sports analogies. Right?
Yeah.
Dart throwers average about half of the maximum score. The best people in the world occasionally get the high score, but normally the best people in the world get about half of the highest score. There's an awful lot of cases where I can do everything right and I'm still wrong.
Yeah.
And then if you do hard things like how I'm going to make this component work with that component when neither of them are well documented. Not that we would run into those situations. Right? Then I'm wrong more.
Yeah.
And so as I thought more and more time about it, it's like, no, I should just foundationalize. Look, I'm wrong a lot and you're wrong a lot. And so how do I take that position seriously? How do I take, right? Okay, so if I disagree with you, if we do politics and I have one opinion and you have another opinion because you're a different party or whatever, what's my proper stance? Well, my proper stance is, I know Austin, Austin's smart, there's a real chance I'm wrong, right? Mm-hmm. In fact, because I know Austin's smart, I have to start that there's about a 50-50% chance that one of us is right, that Austin is right instead of me, right? Mm-hmm. I can't start from the point of view that, hey, I'm more likely to be right because I'm me. Yeah, that's nonsense. That's not an epistemically proper point of view. Mm-hmm. So if I disagree with somebody, that automatically adjusts my position. If I disagree with somebody who I know is thinking and taking stuff seriously, that automatically adjusts my position, right? And it means that, I mean, you, so, and here's the trick. You do this while programming. We mob, right? Mm-hmm. So you get into a mob and Chris says, I think we should do it this way. And I say, Chris, I think you're nuts. And then I say, you're driving, let's go, do it your way.
Yeah.
Right? I trust the people I'm working with. I've learned enough to take people's thinking seriously. Mm-hmm. And so this notion that no, they're a thinker, and like what I found not having worked with Chris is I expect I would find that if I worked with Chris, he'd be right half the time, maybe more than half the time. And so even when I think he's nuts, it's worth taking his ideas seriously.
Yep.
In fact, I start most of my sentences with, I could be crazy.
Yeah. But taking, there's a lot of people who will start there, but they don't actually take it seriously.
Yeah.
And I mean, yes. So I agree with you. Yes, I might be wrong. Here's how I'm thinking about it. Show me that I'm wrong. I'm good with that. Yep. Let's discover truth together.
Yeah. And I think this blends well with something that I know you're passionate about, Chris, was experimentation, right? So I think that from the interpersonal to communication to tech to product, all our methodology or our standpoint should be that we're going to be wrong, right? You know, so I just came out of a mob where we were trying to format a page correctly, and it took 20 experiments to be right. So we, you know, we operate in a way where we know we're going to be wrong. You go to interpersonal and communication, right? I think one thing I learned from Chris was it's probably going to miscommunicate. So you run an experiment and then you check, you run experiment and check, right? And then with product, we think we have the greatest idea in the world, but until you run the experiment in the market, you don't really know, right? And so, I think.
But, yeah. And so bringing it all the way back, I think that's what the whole agile model sits on, right? This historical model of programming is hero. Get somebody who's good enough and let them solve the problem, right? Mm-hmm. And they're going to be right. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
The follow-up model, which everybody likes to call waterfall, I don't really, I like to call it, it's a spreadsheet model, plan, schedule, manage,
yeah.
Right? Right? The spreadsheet model is great. The theory is if we're careful enough and we plan enough, then we can be right. The agile model is, look, we're going to be wrong. Things are going to change. It's unpredictable. What can we do given that we're starting from a, we're going to be wrong?
Yeah.
Right? And so that's a really big twist for most people. And if you come from the humility, mobbing is one of the best approaches to humility I know.
Yep.
Right? But if you come from a humility point of view, it's a very different thing. And it's hard to communicate sometimes across the humility border. Well, yeah. How do you make a plan that's going to be right? Well, how do you make sure you're right? Well, we don't. We're not.
And then all of a sudden, that's the waste of money that they're afraid of. And in reality, they say, we're going to be right. We're going to plan for it. And then years later, they identify that they can't support financially because they've taken out all those loans or not done dishes for 6 months, I think.
Yeah.
Gotcha. That's super cool. Right on. Let's see.
Wait, can I advertise for like 30 seconds?
Yeah.
10 seconds?
Yeah.
10 seconds. I have to do this advertising for 30 seconds just because that happens to be there. You like metaphor?
Yeah.
You know, I wrote a fairy tale about Scrum. This is the French version.
Nice.
The Scrum Princess.
Nice.
Right?
Oh my goodness.
Scrum as a fairy tale. It is a magnificent little metaphor. Right?
All right.
Okay, that was me advertising.
I'll be sure to look that up for sure.
Can I get a PDF to read my kids tonight? For
It's on Kindle. It's cheap.
Okay, all right.
Like, I there's a lot of people who said, hey, yeah, I was able to explain to my spouse what I actually do.
Nice. Okay. So you had a topic here, the facets of Agile or Agile facets. Can you maybe dig into that a little bit? And
cool. So when I talk about Agile, if you go out and you say, hey, what's Agile? And you ask 100 people who are kind of in the IT industry.
Yeah.
About 10 of them say, what? Right? And about 85 of them say, that's Scrum, right?
Mm.
Yeah.
Right? So I went about, and you heard the story, I started in XP. And so all these people who think Agile and Scrum mean the same thing have been bothering me for, I don't know, 20 years, right? And then SAFe came along, and SAFe wanted to focus all of our attention on the enterprise side of Agile,
mm-hmm.
right? And so I started trying to draw out, okay, what pieces actually make Agile work, right? Mm. What pieces do you need? And my short version is, you can't leave any of them out.
Mm.
We've already talked about how you do Scrum, you don't do your tech dishes, and a year into the project, you're done because it's excavation now. Mm. It's not actually solving any problems, right?
Yeah.
What facets do we need for Agile to work? I have an acronym problem personally, so I can't actually come up with a set of ideas without sticking them into an acronym. Right? My acronym for this is PEPPER.
Nice.
Yeah.
Right? You need the process side of Agile to work, like Scrum. Scrum calls itself a process framework. I suggest we take it seriously.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You need the execution or the tech side of Agile. If you're doing technical Agile in software and you don't do the tech side, things are going to break.
Yeah.
You probably have 6 to 9 months before they break, but they're going to break if you don't handle it.
Yeah.
Right? I further subdivide the execution side of Agile into the ops side. Hey, do we have pipelines? Do we have cloud? Do we have that? There's the test automation side, which is really powerful and a big whole category. And there's the dev side, which is what I usually talk about. And I think y'all do too with the craftsmanship side of things. But there's all three facets. And so I get frustrated when somebody goes, oh yeah, we do tech Agile and they only talk ops.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So process execution, product, right? Yeah. Discovering what product to build is like, that's what software is about, is discovering what product we should be building. Yeah. And Scrum is lovely, but it says, you should have a product owner that'll handle that. And that just doesn't seem like guidance to me.
Yeah.
It's isolation from the problem or black boxing.
Yeah, let's black box, let's put a superhero in there. And so long as they have a cape, everything will be okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they try to train them, but it's still, yeah, I see the criticism for sure. Yeah.
Well, it's not that you can't do it. I think the product owner is the hardest role in Scrum.
Yeah.
I think it's incredibly big. I don't think I know any one person who has all of the proper skills to do a product owner the way Scrum put it together.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. It's actually a team job to be product owner.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the product side of agility is essential, and it's way underdeveloped, right? And so there's some people talking about it. I mean, Mark Schwartz has The Art of Business Agility. out, and there's organizations that are focused on product agility,
yeah.
right? And I work for one of them right now, and C Prime's product agility division.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, there are people who actually focus on that. Besides that, there's the people side of Agile. If you listen to LinkedIn, that's the only topic in Agile, right?
Nice.
Right? Now, there's an argument to be made that it's the most important topic in Agile is how do you actually work with other human beings and do work together? Mm-hmm. And that's a huge chunk of Agile. But if you only do the people side and you don't do the process side, well, we run into problems. And if you only do the process side and you don't do the tech side, you run into problems. And right, you have to do each of these. Now, on top of all of that, there's the enterprise side of Agile, right? We know SAFe wants to talk about that all of the time, right? We know Scrum at Scale or LASS wants to talk about it part of the time, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But in practice, it's a real part and it's a solid sixth of our problem, right? You need to handle the question of how do you deal with the executive's real problems of directing the organization and product? You need, and SAFe is actually really good at that problem, right?
Mm-hmm.
You need to deal with the team's problems of how do you actually get software developed and how do you make sure the organization doesn't get in the way?
Mm-hmm.
Right? I don't feel like SAFe handles that at all, but that's a component of enterprise agility, right? Then you need to deal with topics like org change. How do you move from one place to another? There's PhD programs in org change. It's a big topic.
Yeah.
Whereas that is part of our agility discussions.
Mm.
Not in enough places in my experience.
Mm.
Right? And so there's all of that. And then my experience says the biggest reason I see failure in agility is the reasons.
Mm.
People say, do a stand-up every day, have a retrospective every 2 weeks. And they don't say, no, here's the goal we're chasing. We think a stand-up will help you achieve this goal.
Yeah.
A retrospective will help you achieve the goal. And so almost every time I've seen agile failure over time, it has come from trying to say, here are the steps to do, instead of saying, here are the goals we're trying to achieve. These steps should help us get there. Because if you don't say the goals, then people say, do these steps, and they do the steps in name only in order to achieve the goals they're aware of.
Yep. Yeah, that helps a lot. I like, so the acronym's called PEPPER, right, you said?
Yeah.
And it reminds me of, it was kind of an asynchronous conversation between, this is going back 5-7 years or so, but it was when I was first learning about extreme programming well, I think I kind of heard of it before. And it was a conversation with a manager, an extreme programming guru, and myself. And basically it was like, hey, these are the things that have worked well in extreme programming. And the manager was kind of like, well, can I take this one thing and use that? Or can I take these two things and use that and not do the other things? And he's like, yes, you can, but you'll have problems. And that's kind of what I've heard throughout your whole thing. Like, you can do the P, you can do parts of it, and you can maybe survive, but you'll have problems, right? You know?
Yeah. So. Right. And yeah. I mean, we could take all week and discuss, hey, if you do this but not that, what problem do you see? And we could probably just pull it out from experience.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, right on.
I like your the notion that the product side of agility is underdeveloped. And I feel like, you know, if you're ever on YouTube or something and you're looking up tutorials, right, there's like 10 million beginner tutorials for something, right? But as you get farther and farther along in the tutorials, it's like just fewer and fewer until it's just non-existent. You got to go figure it out on your own. And so it's almost like by the time the product's built, no one's really gotten to the point where the product's built properly enough to realize that like that is a problem in the first place. And that like that's why it's underdeveloped, because everybody's just stuck on the first two the whole time. And the progression hasn't been fully worked out yet. And so as more people adopt earlier stages of the pepper, then by the time you get to the product, there's fewer tutorials, there's fewer explanations on how to move forward with that. I think that's true. I think that the product side of agility, no one realizes that they built the wrong thing until it was way too late, or, you know, kind of talking of going back to the sprinter fall or whatever you want to call it. You know, they've sprinted for 2 years and then at the end of the 2 years, they realize that they built the wrong thing, but then people have just left the company at that point because the average software development career at a company typically is 2 years. And so now you're in a situation where no one remembers, and then no one really remembers to evaluate whether the product was the right thing to build in the first place anyway. So I don't know. I just thought that was kind of funny.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Yeah. I've seen, so what's interesting to me is everybody I see who does XP for 5 years goes, gosh, we're missing a product part, and they end up inventing one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm really liking the pepper thing. And one follow-up question before we close out is if you're going to eat the pepper, do you digest it at once? You know, how does someone go about learning the all the things?
So if you're going to say, where do I want to start? It's really hard. I want to start personally somewhere between the people and the execution side of this, right? I need to build a social culture inside of a team where we can do stuff together. Mm. And I need to build the tech skills to be able to do the things, right? And so I lean in the direction of chasing those first and chasing process and product topics later, right? And if you don't fix the enterprise thing, then the enterprise incentives are going to eat your system, right?
Yeah.
But I don't usually start there.
Yeah.
Right. And so from my point of view, I want to start with building a team with the good human interactions and the good technical skills and expand out from there, because like I can't solve product problems if I can't change my code.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
So, but that's how I want to do it. And that kind of matches what I think y'all focus on in your mob approach, right? You're dealing with the social human interactions and you're focused on the technical pieces first. Yep. And getting better at product is something we can do once we've got those pieces in place. And then the question of how much process to add into this is a great question. And the question of, hey, what enterprise incentives? Can we stop the individual performance nonsense? Because if I pay Chris for how much he gets done by himself, then how much is he going to help them all, right? Really?
No, I really like that a lot. It almost reminds me of what you say, Chris, often when a new project is started, start with a test, or at least very soon, and then have a pipeline, and then you have something to start running product experiments with, right? But until you have that foundation, it's really hard to do product discovery, right?
And I'll just throw out there you kind of have to create an ecosystem, right? Like corporate antibodies can come in and just destroy anything agile that you have at any point, right? And so there's kind of like something around organizational change where you have like buy-in but I think that one of the most important things is just willingness to experiment in any place and just bringing it on. Cause if you're in an organization that immediately expels anything new, then nothing in Pepper can really exist. Right.
Yes. Yeah.
And so there is like that prerequisite of just making sure that the organization's not going to eject the change entirely. And sometimes that's at the executive level, sometimes that's at the individual contributor level. I think both sides in some way can resist those things in a very strong way. So breaking down those barriers might be a first step, and then the incremental, like you said, can come at that point, right? Can have a healthy growing area.
I said once that the reasons not getting established, hey, here's what we are trying to do clear, is my biggest reason to see agile failure, right?
Yeah.
Like maybe an executive has some loose notion, but the executive notion isn't shared by the managers. The manager's notion isn't shared by the devs.
Yep.
My second biggest reason to see agile transformations fail is executive turnover.
That's
that executive leaves, new one comes in, new rules.
Yeah.
Yep. I've seen that before as well. Yeah. That's
I don't know. That's not an easy one.
Yeah. So maybe we'll end with that, the question there for the audience. Yeah. So we're coming up on time. Kyle, can you would you like to share or plug anything before we close?
If you're gonna do agile, take seriously all of the pieces. Don't figure you're gonna do just the process side and get to agility.
Yeah.
Cool.
Be sure to find the, what was it, the Scrum Princess? Is that what it's called? Yeah, all right.
The Scrum Princess.
You'll find that.
Look for me.
And I'll also plug Kyle is quite active on LinkedIn and has fantastic content often. So we'll put a link to that in the show notes as well. So, Chris, you want to close us? Yeah.
All right. So if anything in this episode you think is really going to be useful for somebody that you know, maybe they're struggling with some of these concepts, please share this video with them. I think that you have an opportunity now to help them. And then like and subscribe, and we will see you next time. And thanks, Kyle, for joining us today. It's been a great time. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
It was fun.